A very warm welcome to everyone present, and thank you very much for joining us today to discuss the operating and financial performance of our company for the first quarter ended 30th June 2020. During Q1 FY 2021, revenues declined by 42% YoY to 406 crore. Non-South markets declined by 47%, while South declined by 38%. Non-South markets saw a larger impact due to more extended lockdowns, whereas opening up in South saw progressively improved demand in states such as Karnataka and Kerala. Similarly, all three product segments were impacted in the quarter, marked by various stages of lockdown and disruptions. While electrical products were the least impacted, electronic segment saw a sharper decline based on its linkage with larger appliances, which sees large demand in summer season like ACs. Gross margins contracted by 334 basis points YoY to 29.2%, owing to lower capacity utilization and product mix. However, gross margin improved in each successive month and had reverted back to normative levels in June. EBITDA margin for the quarter was 2.2% as compared to 10.2% YoY due to decline in turnover. Profit after tax during the quarter was accordingly subdued at 3.6 crore. PAT margin contracted to 0.9% as against 7.5% in Q1 last year. While these headline numbers indicate the effect of COVID-19 pandemic along the expected lines, we believe the business has demonstrated strong resilience in facing these extremely challenging times. We have put in place cost containment measures, which will partly offset the impact of loss of turnover. Working capital has improved steadily as available inventory has been used to drive revenues. Collections were strong, and we have been able to reduce our debtor days, resulting in a total cash generation of 215 crore during the quarter. Even before COVID-19 pandemic, there was weakness in consumer demand based on conditions of tight liquidity and reduced discretionary spending. FY 2021 had opened in difficult circumstances, but we believe that as the situation reverts to greater normalcy, we have the requisite framework to drive volume growth momentum by expanding further into non-South markets, introducing new and innovative products, and entering additional product categories. We have put in place best-in-class processes and systems to future-proof the organization and create the framework for a secular growth. We will continue to build upon our competitive positioning in the consumer electricals, electronics, and consumer durable industry to drive value for all stakeholders. On that note, I would like to thank you once again for your participation and would like to hand over the floor to the moderator for question and answers. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use hand.
Hello?
Hello? Hello?
Yeah,
Yeah, I think, I don't know what's going on. Anyway, we'll hold.
Yeah. You don't hear anything, do you?
I think we are out of the call, I think maybe. I don't know. We'll just hold and see. Let them call.
Ravi, your line is in talk mode. You can go ahead, please.
Hello. Hi, sir.
Yes, hi. Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah. Sir, just wanted to check with you, in terms of demand from metro and non-metro, how different has it been across the products? Second question is with respect to July demand, how it is panning out?
Ram, you want to take this one?
Yeah. I think the non-metros have been better than metros. I think metros are impacted for various reasons. That's the first question. Non-metros have been better than metros. Also, I think that the early part of the lockdown, the non-metros have been operational, formally, informally also it looks like, based on the inventory level and the offtake that we have been able to observe. Yeah. Coming to July, I think July is comparable to June, bit better actually. But what has happened is, after about 12th or 13th, right, many areas have gone into lockdown. So as an example, let us say that around 75-76% of the outlets that we serve were open at the beginning of the month, and that had dropped to about 55-54 by around 17th-18th, yeah. And this has now recovered around 23rd-24th to something like I would say closer to 70%, yeah. So that basically happened because many places progressively got added into the lockdown, right? Like Karnataka went in as an example, or some parts of Maharashtra. So it's a very dynamic situation, and even the outlet numbers are changing week on week and month on month. Yeah.
Got it, sir. And in terms of cost wise, so basically, we had seen employee cost drop by around 10%. So is it like, was it a salary cut or something which we are given to employees, or how should we look at employee cost for the year?
Sudarshan, you want to go for this?
Yeah, okay. We've not resorted to any salary cuts or whatever. We are paying both on-roll employees and contract labor. On a full year basis, that call we will take perhaps in 6 months or 8 months. For now, we have held on to the increment, so there's been no cost increase. Therefore, it is flat. We will review the situation later and see if we decide to give an increment or not. So we'll know
the reduction could be because we are not paying variable pay because our targets are not getting achieved.
Yeah. Got it, sir. Got it. And in terms of ad spends also, how is it likely to pan out? Usually, we spend around 3-4% of top line also. So.
See, the business is not back to normal. Even today, like Ram mentioned, we are serving only 70% of customers. So when business goes to normal, at that time we will review this. But as of now, we are not planning to spend. It's like bare minimum, as you can see, ad spend. And I guess it will be very similar kind of strategy taken by all peers.
Just one more point. The supply side is also very dynamic, right? So, different areas get into containment zones, so different suppliers or supply sources can get impacted. And also, the attendance is, thin and weak, generally operating between 50-70% at these places. So I think, I think marketers will take some more time before they open their purse because, supply has to be streamlined also.
Got it, sir. And my last question is with respect to commodity prices, them softening, will it be a big advantage to us in terms of gross margins and all these things?
I don't think commodity prices have softened. Specifically, if you ask, copper actually has shot up by close to, about 20% increase in copper has happened. Plastic prices have come down, but unfortunately, when the prices were at its lowest, we were not able to buy anything because of the lockdown. Sudarshan, you want to just explain this?
No, it's next year. The copper prices have gone up, and that sort of gets reflected in the wire selling price. It's not much of an impact. The other companies don't make too much of an impact.
We have not seen huge reduction in commodity prices vis-a-vis, let's take Jan or Feb, in other materials.
Yeah. Got it, sir. Yeah, thanks a lot for the answer.
Thank you. We would request the participants to please press star and one to ask a question. The next question is from the line of Renu Baid from IIFL. Please go ahead.
Just to understand a bit more on the inventory side, you mentioned that the company has pretty much used the inventory which it had to drive revenues. So how would be the inventory across the channel partners also? And have we seen the channel partners starting to upstock again, or they continue to remain a bit more averse on the pre-stocking trends?
Ram, you want to take this?
Yeah.
channel partners today, I mean, inventory is, you know, what I would say, inventory has normalized. I would say a little lower than normal. I think on an average, what we are observing is, you know, inventory would be down to about 30 days, you know, including, you know, we are looking at our, I'm talking about a total channel inventory, mm-hmm. which is a bit lower than normal because, you know, this includes the direct and indirect. So, yes, there is, you know, they are, you know, thinner than, you know, what they would be before. But I think this is also how they are operating now compared to the way they were operating before.
Sure. And so based on the feelers that you have from the market in terms of consumption patterns, what is the expectation of we getting back to normalized 100% levels as last year's? Should festive season be the next catalyst for demand to pick up, or do you think the demand trends have been much more significantly impacted from a medium-term perspective?
See, I think we are in a position where we are not able to predict. Please understand this is a health issue, so without a health solution, really, neither me or Ram or Sudarshan will be able to give you an answer on this. It is really depends on, you know, when the country is able to tide over this crisis together and the markets one by one can open fully. Every day, every district is a different case, so it's very volatile in that sense. So it is very difficult to make any kind of prediction. Ram, you want to add anything to this?
No, I just wanted to say the same thing. You know, for example, you know, we started this month and, you know, we were feeling that, you know, it would go well. And then, you know, the, you know, one by one, the lockdowns started to get announced and, you know, the number of outlets that we could, you know, to which we could supply, you know, shrunk by 30 odd percent, right? And then, you know, now we are seeing from 23, 24, you know, the outlets are coming back, right? And we can see the consequence of that directly, you know, in numbers coming through, yeah? So,
what I was also trying to ask was that probably in the next couple of months or by the end of 2Q, if the situation normalizes.
That's what Mithun was saying, right? See, it all depends because, you know, both the supply side and demand side, you know, picture is changing from time to time because it's not only a matter of demand, right? It's also a matter of supply.
So, I think I'll just supplement this. See, Kerala had the best way of managing COVID in the beginning part of this pandemic.
Correct.
Okay. But right now, we are hitting 1,500 cases a day. What it means is that no state can effectively manage this. So, whenever the cases go up, they will lock it down and then they will restart again from zero. So, this process is going to continue over and over again till we have a vaccine. That's what I think. So, we can't really comment when we will go back to 100%.
Sure. But in general, what has been the feedback or inputs in terms of the demand pattern, both from secondary as well as tertiary sales? Have they also moved in line or how is it?
Yeah, it's, so wherever markets are opening and cases are relatively lower and people are feeling relatively safe to come out, the sales are happening. So that is definitely there. We can't really split this between what is the pent-up demand and what is the real demand. Okay, that split up none of us have. But what we can safely say is that 70 to 80% of last year's sale should happen, provided we don't have a nationwide lockdown. This is what we believe. So that's the broad number I can say. It can go up, provided there are no, you know, localized lockdowns and stuff like that. It's really difficult to say. I mean, we really can't give you any guidance. That's the honest truth.
Sure. So I have a couple of more questions. I'll get back in the queue. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sonali Selgaonkar from Jefferies India. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity. So my first question is regarding the unfavorable product mix that you have mentioned in the presentation. Any more color you would like to add as to which appliances, you know, have led to the maximum impact on our gross margins?
So if you look at the stabilizer business is the most impacted because in Q1 we typically sell air conditioner stabilizers and that pretty much has not happened. So they have taken the biggest hit and it is a product with higher gross margin. So it has definitely pulled down overall gross margin for the company. This has been one of the biggest impacts.
Understand. My second question is, I understand that there's a lot of uncertainty in the, you know, overall demand and the business scenario, but any rough EBITDA margin you would like to, you know, point out as to what we should expect in FY21, any range, considering that the first quarter was quite lower than what we generally register?
See, I think what we've seen is that we have given in the analyst presentation month-wise gross margin for April, May and June. So that gives you some color that, you know, at that kind of a revenue in June, what we did, that kind of a gross margin is possible. That's all I can say as of now. Sudarshan, you want to add anything to this?
Yeah, that's all. I think if you are able to sell maybe 80 to 90% of last year, margins will look like that. That's the best we can.
So I think if you are able to do 80 to 90% of last year, we could hit 8 to 10% EBITDA margins, correct?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah.
Something like that. But that's all we can say.
Understand. So in our factories right now, what kind of utilization are we operating at?
Ram, you want to take this?
Yeah, I think wire factories are, you know, running, you know, full steam. So the electrical categories are having good demand, right, as I think Mithun outlined in his statement. So there, you know, the capacity utilization is, you know, very good, yeah. And, you know, in the other cases, you know, the, you know, utilization is in line with, you know, normal business requirement at this stage. Because what we did is, you know, our focus initially in the first 2 months was to go, you know, make sure that, you know, we collect all the monies and, you know, our cash position gets better. So our focus, you know, I would say in May and June was primarily towards, you know, collections and, you know, and that we have been able to get to a reasonably decent place. So, mostly, therefore, you know, we have focused on, you know, utilizing the, you know, available inventory on hand and, you know, our factories have started, you know, somewhere around middle of June, you know, barring the wire factory. So what I would say, you know, June, July, you know, their run should be, you know, okay, should not be an issue. Yeah.
So we are basically supplying to whatever demand that is there. We are not going to produce and then force the sales team to sell. So that's what I think the basic point is.
Thank you. Sonali, we would request you to please come back to the question queue for any follow-up questions as we have several participants waiting for their turn. Also, we would request the participants to please limit your questions to two per participant. The next question is from the line of Achal Dohade from JM Financial. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. My first question was with respect to, you know, in terms of the demand pattern, are you seeing any downtrading in general in the industry as well as for our product? And two, are you also seeing any disruption at the in the unorganized industry?
So as of now, we can't get any clear trends on down trading. You know, like Ram mentioned, one of the products that is selling very well is wires, where you know, we only have really, you know, one or two SKUs in terms of pricing positioning. So really, we can't measure that. We have not seen that, you know, premium product is not selling and non-premium product is selling. We have not seen that kind of a trend. Sales are secular in that sense. I think we have to understand that what's right now happening is a pull demand. That means actually retailers and distributors are calling us for stocks and then we are supplying. We are not shoving anything down the pipe or channel. So what we believe is, you know, what we are supplying to is kind of like the normative demand. That is the first part of the question. So, no, we don't have any evidence of downtrading as yet. What is the second one?
With respect to the unorganized industry?
Yes. In the case of wires and cables, definitely we are feeling that there is an absence of the unorganized industry and definitely all the brands are benefiting as of now. Yes, that evidence
and
is there.
In the other product category, sir?
No evidence.
No. Got it. And the second question was, with respect to the debtors, I see that QOQ, we have seen a reduction in the inventory. Can you help us with the channel financing, which was as of March 20 and June 20? Could you please help us with that?
Sudarshan? Between March and June, there's not much difference. It's about the same.
Are you able to help us with the quantum, sir?
The reduction in debtors is an actual reduction in debtors, not because of channel financing, if that's what it is.
Correct.
I think it's an actual reduction in debtors.
Yeah.
Sure, sure. Would you be able to give the quantum? What is the channel financing outstanding as of June?
The outstanding?
Rather, channel financing done as of 30th of June.
What is the total book of channel finance?
Total outstanding will be about 80 or 90 crores.
Got it. Great, sir. I'll come back in the queue for further follow-up. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Mayank Bhandari from BNP Securities. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. Sir, I wanted to understand particularly the consumer digital. How has been the growth in different categories like fans, kitchen appliances? And considering that we have a low base, the growth looks, this is a pretty sharp regrowth given that other competitors have given good commentary in terms of kitchen, appliances, air cooler, and fans.
Ram, you want to take this?
Yeah. So I think, as Mithun said, we are not, aggressively pushing numbers into trade at this time. We are just feeding, whatever demand is coming from the market. Yeah. And, across channel, our inventory is a little lower than desirable in our key markets, yeah, particularly south. Yeah. So that's the situation. Second thing is, you will generally see a trend in this environment that, leading brands and, brands with, width and depth of distribution will have some advantage over other brands. That is the second point. The third point we want to make is, by and large, our performance is similar to others. Maybe it's possible, the weightage of e-commerce in some of our newer categories is not, comparable, as, they are slower to enter e-commerce compared to, let's say, a fertilizer or water heater. So, I think whereas in some of the players where you might have sensed, better demand in kitchen and all, they have a stronger presence in e-commerce. Also, kitchen and all is a category also has a stronger presence in organized retail also. Okay. So I think, those influences are also there, in the overall number. Yeah. But I think by and large, we will not be way off.
Yeah. Okay. And sir, any other cost-saving initiatives apart from the employee cost and the advertisement expense?
No, by and large, like anybody and everybody in the marketplace, right? The cost sets are same, across companies, yeah. And we are focusing on these cost sets, whether it is, establishment costs like rent, travel, yeah, or whether it is, people and stuff like
yeah.
that.
And
but
discretionary in nature.
So whatever is discretionary in nature, we are tackling. Yeah?
Okay. And lastly, sir, what would be the capex? Any guidance for capex this year?
Sudarshan, this year capex.
Right now, other than essential capex, things are on hold. We've got a couple of plans to finish. There is not too much of outstanding things left. Other than certain IT infra and things like that, we don't see much capex happening at least.
We may have a capex for a wire plant, which is about 15 to 20 crore, and then probably another 10 crore of IT and all this. Maybe 30-35 crore of capex could happen at the max.
Okay. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Bhavin A. from SBI Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. Just one question from my side. Given the current pandemic, what is it that you are doing differently which will help the company improve more on a structural basis? And if you could, it would be interesting if you could talk about the investments that you will be doing in terms of people, which will be difficult to hire in other circumstances, or the investment in research or development, innovation, will be helpful to know your thoughts on this.
So we were working on a digital workplace as a concept, about started from 2 years back. So we started with a world-class VC system. We started with a world-class integration of VC system with teams, Microsoft Teams. Then we invested in something called Degrade, which is a learning platform which can be used for both company, created content and external paid content as the manager, so wishes. So we have invested a lot of tech, not knowing that this pandemic is coming in our way, and now we are actually using a lot of that. We have constant training programs for not only our own employees, but even for key channel partners and their staff on how to sell a particular product to customer, technical selling. So we are using this time to beef up, those kind of activities because there is absolutely no, visibility on when, people can go visit the market, whether it's safe to visit the market and all that. So all the work is done over phones and, video conferencing. So I think we will probably accelerate that journey into a digital enterprise a little faster. I mean, we had put some milestones, but COVID has forced us to, fast track some of those milestones. This is one side. In terms of people hiring, I think from 2015 to 2020, we have hired quite a lot of people, and you will see our ballooning of employee costs that has happened. So I don't think we need to hire any more key resource. Not a lot of people and positions are left to be filled, in my view. There are very few and far between, which when we find the right resource, we will take them on board. The second is on e-commerce. We started the journey on e-commerce 2 years back, and now we are getting very good traction. Our margins on e-commerce are far superior than what we do in any other channel, and it's growing very, very fast. And we have even launched certain products where e-commerce is the first channel of choice, and we only will launch them in offline much later. So all these experiments are working well. I will also ask Ram to supplement any more to these.
So actually, we've been having a long-term journey for organization capability building. Much of the focus, the last 5 years have been on the supply side. And mainly, we've been working on cost. We've been working on insourcing manufacturing. And we have also been working on working capital. So that's been our work, and there are some proofs related to that, which we should be able to capture over a period of time. But more than the financial benefit, or the capability that is getting built, these are also built on a robust digital friendly tech ecosystem. So I think that a lot of focus in V-Guard has been on this over the last 5 years, and which I think maybe another year or two we will continue, so that our work on the supply side there will be complete and comprehensive. We have commenced work on the market side, fundamentally to help us to build leading capability on the market side, where we are trying to embrace technology into our marketing process. And this work is just we started about 6 months back before the lockdown has started. That's something that we will continue over the next 3 to 4 years. These are like long-term journey, and fundamentally what this journey is doing is helping us to leapfrog our capability, whether it's manufacturing, whether it is product, whether it is go-to-market. It's fundamentally building leading capabilities in this area. And also what it is doing is this is all being accompanied with a roadmap for the enterprise digitization, which Mukund was earlier referring to. The near-term benefit of enterprise digitization is basically connecting the organization for employee productivity, which I think he outlined, and the long-term benefit is related to some of the areas that I've talked about. So we have a pretty robust program. I mean, this is a program which has been on for the last 4 to 5 years, and we have a roadmap for the next 3 to 4 years. And, we are busy focusing on that, and we are busy putting that in place.
Yes, thank you so much for an elaborate answer. Much really appreciate.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Akshay Bhor from Premji Invest. Please go ahead.
Hi team, thanks for taking my questions. I actually want to understand a little bit on the historical performance. If I look at pre-COVID, about 4 to 6 quarters, the performance has been slightly tepid, both as compared to your own historical performance and then even with respect to peers as well. And this is in light of very good summers last year, should have been favorable to some of the portfolio, and then winters as well. So just wanted to understand what is it that that is kind of how can we attribute this underperformance to? What can we attribute and within that specifically, is there any component of newer competitors that are coming into especially in the Kerala market that you pointed out sometime in the past? Any kind of helpful text?
So see, what has been happening is, I think post demon and GST, the market growth had slowed down significantly for all players. So every company in India was getting into every product category, and we also got hit in that mishmash there, wherein which maybe 20-30 brands entered water heater business, which is a 1500 crore category. And then the same thing happened, with even stabilizer, I'm told that Philips also now has stabilizers. People started looking at companies with decent margin and just started entering categories. I should not be talking about it because we have also entered adjacent category. But the thing is, when everyone in the market tries to enter every category, there is going to be a bloodbath. And that you will see not only with us, in time you will see with other companies as well. So yes, there is a period where we had to, show restraint, not, react by dropping price and all that. We have lost share also. We have lost revenues also. But our margins are intact. I think after 4-5 years, many of these people will leave. I mean, and you will hear about many of these companies getting into trouble also. I don't want to specifically name them, but we have some companies who, into batteries that got into kitchen appliances, that got into trouble. So stuff like that keeps happening. So we can't really stop, competition. It's a free country. Anyone can do pretty much anything. So we're not really one or two quarters. If you look at the last 5 years, we have worked significantly to improve our gross margin. And this has also happened because we chose to, walk away from categories. So we have shut down a loss-making power cable business that was doing close to 90 crores 6 years back. We have shut down, agriculture pump business that was doing 40 crores 5 years back. So last 5-6 years, we have also restructured a lot of our portfolio to have a sharper focus. What does it mean is that, yes, year on year, you will not see such great revenue growth, but our business is very healthy and we are more sharper focused. And it gives us bandwidth to, go after categories that are of better margin profile. Ram, you want to supplement?
Yeah, couple of things. So I think, we have to see the macros also. So, if you broadly look at the macros, see the nominal growth, which used to be at around 14-odd% has dropped to about 8-9%. That's on one side. On the other side, if you look at the last 4 years, significant part of this growth has happened on e-commerce and organized trade. Yeah. I think we have been, late to, enter e-commerce and organized trade on one side. The other side is, while the nominal growth has almost, come down by, 40%, the part of the remaining growth has gone into, organized trade and e-commerce. In the remaining part of the market, a lot of the people have entered, which is what Mithun has been talking about, right? And mainly we have been focusing on the traditional trade, as a company. And, if this macro is understood, I think, the performance would seem, as strong and as good, okay? Because when, 30-40% of the growth is happening outside the area that you focus, right, and you've not participated in that adequately. Because as Nitin said, right, last 2 years we've been working on building capability and we are now pretty happy now that we have the right we are in the right place to, scale up and therefore, because it required a lot of preparation. So that's one context I would like to bring to your notice, right? Second thing, I would like to say is, we, you know, post the demon and DST, right? You know, the companies which were, you know, we used to be an outsourcing company. Yeah, most of our business was outsourced. So when we moved from outsourcing to manufacturing, right, our competitiveness got impacted to the extent of about 4%. So we, you know, that was the, you know, the outsourcing, you know, gave us the advantage to be able to compete with people who had, you know, strong and deep market positions. And which is why you will see now that progressively in the last 3-4 years, you know, we have gone in for insourcing manufacturing to the company. Yeah. So I think, you know, this period is also a period, you know, where we have, you know, overcome this challenge, you know, where we lost this competitiveness and, you know, and we were able to restore our margins and, you know, hold, and improve our margins in this environment, because it meant that, you know, relatively, you know, we have to, you know, improve our price positioning in the marketplace. Yeah. 4% is, you know, huge, you know, impact. Yeah. That's the second thing. The third thing is, you know, we've been focusing on, you know, making sure that, you know, we are able to, you know, generate and, you know, convert, you know, our profitability into real cash. Yeah. And you would see that, you will see that in our books today, you know, and you will also see that, you know, much of the CapEx investment that has happened, you know, where we've set up 5-6 factories, you know, over this period, 4 or 5 factories over this period, and some of them are, you know, work in progress. This is, you know, this is a consequence of our ability to generate cash in the business, yeah. So our focus has been fundamentally to, you know, to make our business strong and robust, you know, make sure that, you know, we become healthy and our gross margins are protected and improved. I think we have improved our gross margin to the extent of around 6-8% over the last 5-6 years. Half of it has, you know, gone back into the business in terms of investment, right? You know, to meet the cost on people that we have added and the investment that we have made on the technology side, right? So we are putting money back into the business so that, you know, we become strong and we become competitive. Yeah. So we have invested in manufacturing capability and, you know, R&D and product design and development. Yeah. And the fruit of this, you know, will be visible over a period of time, right? So.
Thanks. This is very detailed and candid as well. Just a quick one, if I may, on the margin front, EBITDA margin front, any aspirations that you have? I've seen your gross margins have seen a very smart improvement last year. Any targets, and also if you could indicate what is the price differential in the non-South region now, which you used to indicate earlier, anything on that front?
See, we had earlier stated that we would like to hit 10% and then improve 0.5% EBITDA every year. But this is at a time when, you know, sales were at a normal run rate. Today, sales were, you know, the quarter gone by 60% of what it should have been. So it's very difficult to say that. So the gross margin will get converted into EBITDA margin the moment, you know, sales at 80-90% of the, you know, usual business. And which I think it has happened in, you know, the month of June, and we are hoping that it can happen going forward. That's as far as the EBITDA margin is concerned. What was the second one?
Trying to understand the pricing differential that you used to talk about in the non-South.
We now don't have much of price positioning difference between South and non-South. We have kind of normalized. I would say it's very negligible. Sudarshan, you want to add anything to this?
Yeah, the prices of South and non-South more or less are the same. There could be some tactical schemes here and there that we run, but otherwise there's not much difference
yeah.
to speak about.
For example, there are some markets in non-South which mirror our margins in South, or probably better.
And
in terms of gross and EBITDA. Yeah.
Thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Charanjit Singh from DSP Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hello, sir.
Yes.
Thanks for the opportunity. So, sir, in terms of now you talked about, you know, market share changes which you would have seen over the last couple of months and now also in this, recent quarter. So you can highlight, you know, any major segments that you would have lost or gained share, or region-wise they would have seen, you know, the intensity much more significant in any particular product segment, if you can give color on that aspect.
Ram, you want to take this?
No, you mean last couple of quarters? I think nothing particular. I think, from time to time, we see, aggression in different categories. Yeah. So we have, we've seen, more intense activity in stabilizers. Sometimes we are seeing it in water heaters. Yeah. But I think before that, sometimes we saw in wires, sometimes it's geographic. Yeah. But usually what happens is, then of course, we try to protect our interests. Yeah. But invariably that comes with a lag. So I think these are some, these are the major categories where, which have, impact on us and, where, we have witnessed these kind of issues. And usually it is geographic. Yeah. I mean, in one or two strong pockets, we see this coming up. It takes, once we sense that, it's getting strong, I think, we react and, but then, we lose some time in the process. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And nothing sustainable.
I think, let me answer it in this way. We decided that we will not buy market share by giving discounts. So let me put it that way. Okay.
Okay.
So we block. So what happens is, we block. So we will block, if we find that, the, action of someone is hurting us, we will block that in that place. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
But then in that place. Yeah.
Okay. And sir, in the last, couple of quarters, we have been, working on our product portfolio, upgrading it, more feature-rich, products. And now with the COVID scenario and a lot of fears in terms of down trading and the kind of, sales which are happening. So how do you see the reaction to our product portfolio, which could be more feature-rich and more, towards the profitable segments which we had moved earlier?
So we have completely revamped our NPD process and we have a very, very clear strategy in place. It follows from the automotive strategy of standardization, simplification and platformization. So the chassis will be the same, the bells and whistles we can add. So if someone doesn't want the bells and whistles, we can remove and sell it at a lower price. So this gives us the flexibility to create a platform and then make it into a super premium product or a super economy product, as the case may be.
Uh-huh. Okay. And so lastly, on the channel mix front, now how is our channel mix, e-commerce versus wholesaler-driven or direct distribution? How is the mix and how do you see now with a lot of technology investments which you have done, do you think that channel mix can change in the favor of e-commerce significantly? And which product segments are you seeing more traction on the e-commerce platforms? And how is the pricing differential in that? Yeah.
So, Ram, you want to take this?
Yeah. So I think, you can look at it at company level or, related category level. I say related category because, if you eliminate some categories like wires, switches, switchgear, pumps, right? These are not, e-commerce friendly categories. But otherwise, at a company level, we would be at, maybe, 2-3%, closer to 3%. And, at a related category level, we'll be about 5-6% today. Yeah? But this is growing fast because, the fundamentals, are in place and, we have tested that over the last 2 years. Yeah? And, as we are able to bring more offerings in, we expect to see traction. Obviously, the traction will be more in categories, where, we have historical strength. So typically you will see a stabilizer, a water heater, getting a, a fan or, kitchen, getting, good traction. Yeah. So I think obviously in order of, our strength in the different categories. Yeah.
Okay. And so in terms of wholesaler versus...
So we are not generally wholesale focused. So mainly, mainly we have been, focused on, direct dealing and distribution. Yeah. And what we are doing now is, we have been able to build a foundation for e-com. And we will be focusing on, growing our business in e-com and organized trade. So that's going to be our focus going forward. Yeah. And we are working towards that. Yeah. So that's a huge opportunity that's available to us, yeah, which we could not participate when the business shift happened about 3-4 years back, as we took time to, build our internal capabilities. Yeah.
Thank you. Currently, we would request you to please come back in the question queue as we have several participants waiting for their turn. The next question is from the line of Manish Agarwal from Edelweiss. Please go ahead.
Hi, so just one couple of questions from my end. Firstly, is there some fatigue at the dealer channel level, basically where they are not willing to keep, you know, high inventories? Like maybe if they're carrying a 30 to 40 days of inventory, now they are kind of not willing to take more than 15 to 20 days of inventory. Are you seeing something like that happening?
Ram, you want to take this?
Yeah. Yeah, the channel is operating on lower than normal inventory because, you know, there is still uncertainty that is visible. So, in general, the inventory has come down over a period of time. Yeah. And, the regular stocking, that one would typically see is not visible today. Right? It's also visible in the screen with which, cash has come back from the market. Yeah.
Okay. So, is it something to do with any financing arrangement that channels would have of themselves with
they have thinned their inventory, yeah, and they have thinned their inventory probably because the situation is uncertain, right? And so people are not stocking too much. And I think mostly, not just us, but all companies are at this stage, they are more busy feeding demand. Because I think that, if everybody were to push sales, I am not sure supply will keep pace. Okay, if you're looking at, because the supplier, all the factories are open. Many of them are operating at 50% to 60% manpower, is what we are observing. I'm talking about raw material, packaging material and stuff like that. And some of these are periodically going into containment and coming back after a week or a fortnight and stuff like that also. So all these things we are observing, and therefore, what we feel is, it will take some more time, before things will normalize. I think, maybe couple of months down the line, we would be in a better position to, develop a point of view on this. I think right now, people are not, are just buying hand to mouth. So what we are observing is, we get a more even sale through the month, right? So, and, practically, we are getting flat sales, every day through the month. This is something that I have never seen before because in the past, it would be more sale towards the month end. But now it's more even right through the month, right?
Okay.
And it's replenishment.
Thank you, sir.
There is no urgency to buy on a first or a second or a third or a fourth, right? Yeah, but typically what we see is, we see almost the same number, running right through the month.
Okay. So the demand pattern has changed, channel's demand pattern has also changed, we can say.
No, I think that they are just, buying to requirement, right?
Yeah. So I think, earlier what was happening was they were having 45 days of inventory, and during the month that they will negotiate and then they will buy more, as a bulk volume. But now they're buying 25% each week or 20% each week.
Okay. Thanks, sir. That was very helpful.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Prashant Kuti from Sundaram Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity, sir. So firstly, the first question is in terms of, you just spoke about even before COVID, there was a lot of competition which kind of entered the market and probably would not want to respond to it. But just want to ask, is the overall landscape itself changing? So because you're also hearing a lot of strong players also entering into a lot of these markets, be it appliances market or be it for that matter kitchen appliances, or for that matter switch gears, lighting, and so on and so forth. So is the competitive landscape even more severe as compared to what it was thought by you earlier? And any changes in strategy which you would like to make on account of that?
See, what will happen is when, like I said, after demon and GST, when there was, there was a crash in the GDP growth rates in the country, every company was, not, the core categories were growing at 4-5%. So obviously, it doesn't look nice to show 4-5% growth. So everyone decided to get into every category. Usually companies give it 5 to 7 years. After making losses for 5 to 7 years, they usually shut it down. So that will start now.
Okay. I think also, right, we could see this, so from our point of view, right, so we could see this phenomena coming up. So
So immediately after GST, a couple of things became very clear to us. One is the hyper competition became very clear to us. And the second thing that became clear to us that, companies, which had sourcing-based model, we are losing advantage, okay? And there are two kinds of issues that happen for us, because invariably, into a category, you rely on the capability of the supplier, so your ability to differentiate your offerings is weak, okay? And second thing is, of course, as I said, there is, for us at least, we could see, clear, 3.5 to 4%, gross margin, erosion, relative gross margin erosion happening, because of GST coming in. Because the larger companies which were manufacturing, they could have some advantages. And, so based on that, we, about 2 years back, we have reset our strategy. And we are walking that path, and I think some part of the dividends you would have seen this year in terms of margin growth. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And our priority initially is, to be fit for growth. Being fit for growth means, making sure that, your business has the right margin structure. Yeah. And is churning, sufficient amount of cash so that, we can, invest back into our business. Yeah. So that's our, focus. And, we are running business, with that mind. I think that's what Mithun was trying to say earlier.
I was one more point to make is, when like if you say, if the period of growth, if there is a strong growth happening in the country, it is much more easier to get into a new category and grow than in like in a recessionary kind of an environment like what it's today. So when market is growing at 15%. Market leaders may not even notice that their share is getting lost. But whereas when market growth is 5%, for you to grow, literally someone has to degrow. So that's when the hyper competition starts. So I think now the Indian companies would have realized that it's not easy to enter new categories. It's a long-term haul. So probably the only serious players will remain. Of course, someone will launch and then they will drop price by 20-30% and get some share and all that. But then how long you will do this? You will do it for 3 years, 4 years. After that, eventually you will have to somehow think about making money out of it, right?
Okay. And my second question is, given the current environment, you spoke about that even channel is probably not really liquid. It could be a short-term phenomenon, but you said the channel is also being a very more agile in terms of stocking inventory as well. In this period, are we also looking at probably cutting off some of those low churn products for us, or probably any of those low churn categories for us? Anything on that product front which we're trying to do that probably focus on certain categories, and which would they be, if I may ask? So anything on that front, if you could take on that.
So see, we did not wait for a COVID attack to start doing this. Like I said, we stopped LT cable in 2018. We stopped agricultural pump last year. So we are not afraid to admit mistakes and shut it down, because if ROC for a product is not happening, if the strategic value of the product is not there to the company, we will shut it down. We have no problems in disclosing it. We have no problems in taking the hit. We have written off an entire plant of some 20 crore with this LT cable that was done about 3 years back. So as a company, we are not afraid to do these things, and we'll continue to do it, whether there is COVID or no COVID.
Okay. Sure. Thank you very much, and all the very best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Santosh Yelapu from Ashika Stockbroking. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. I had a couple of questions. First, sir, what are the challenges we see going forward to roll out the new products and also addition of the dealers or distributors across the non-south markets in FY21 and 22? And the second question is, sir, in the consumer durables segment, we with just 80 crores kind of a top line, we did a segment level loss of almost 8-9 crores. This is somewhat a repetition of a mix we had seen in Q1 FY18. Could you throw some colors that despite new breakfast appliance launches, why we saw this kind of a loss?
So first of all, the challenge is, of course, India is, whatever said and done, we have video conferencing and all that. But in India, business is still done the old way. They prefer meeting face to face, especially retailers. They are, a specific stereotype that they really believe in, meeting face to face. So this, as long as this face to face meeting and,
product launch functions and tours and all those don't happen, it is always going to be slightly challenging to go to a new dealer. I mean, you can't just call up a new dealer on the phone and say, can you be my dealer? I mean, so that's going to be one task. But however, we hope that there is some, vaccine, that is coming in our way. And then, probably our sales team can, restart travel. We have to also keep in mind that right now retailers are also scared. They don't want any company representatives coming into their store, because if one of the retailers catches this, then he has to also shut down the store and all kinds of stuff happens. So retailers are also very scared to allow company people to, come into their store. So most of the business gets done on Salesforce.com and video conferencing and phone calls and all that. So that is definitely one of the challenges. What was the second question?
This last quarter, as you said, it's more like 45-50 days of sale. Okay, a mature category where we have higher market share and significant volume to market scale. Obviously, the profitability will be better and, you will see a better health, on a lower volume, okay? But, many of the consumer durable categories, right? Either, you have a AC, you have a water heater which is off-season, okay? Or, you had, air cooler, which was, just getting out of season, okay? So that's on one side, and on the other side you have kitchen and other products, right? These are products that we have entered in the last 3 to 4 years, okay? Obviously, they are going to have a fixed cost, associated with entry into these categories, yeah? And therefore, the break-even point, in this case will be, much, much higher as opposed to break-even point in a mature company. So as you can see, we've done about 58% and, we've been able to, be profitable, yeah? But probably, when you will, break the number by segment, you will find that, maybe, the break-even point in the mature categories is about 40-42%, and the break-even point in the emerging categories will be about 60-70%, because they have still not achieved the scale, commensurate with the investment that has gone in, both at the back end and the front end, in terms of manpower and, other resources like R&D resources. So I think, you have to see it in that light. Yeah. I hope that's clear.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Achal Lohade from JM Financial. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thank you for the opportunity. What I wanted to check was, A, in terms of the festival season, now, given our product portfolio, how important is the festival season for us in general, especially for the South market?
See, so this year, Onam will be the first festival. So once Onam is over, we can tell you how it was. See, please understand that these are not normal times. It's kind of like a world war is happening or something like that. So people are not really in a mood to go, celebrate festivals. I mean, people are not even able to get out of their own house for the festival. So I don't think they are in a mental frame to really do it, go and splurge money and all that. What people are doing is something is breaking down in the house, they're repairing, replacing it. We see a lot of demand for TV stabilizers because a lot of TV is getting sold because now TV is the only source of entertainment for every person. We also see that a lot of demand for UPS systems because everyone is working from home. All the schools are studying, school children are studying from home. So at any cost, your router should not go off. That's a key, asked by all households. So if you look at Kerala, Onam, I mean, the TV sales is one of the biggest ones. And I think Onam TV sales should be decent because not because people want to go and buy TV because of Onam, but because TV is the only source of entertainment. So maybe any number of TV is not enough because you're sitting at home all the time, right? So I think the behavior will change like that. I think the need, so what behavior we saw last year, in terms of people going and buying stuff on auspicious day and all that will change into a need-based buying. I mean, if I need a TV, I'll buy it. If I need a UPS or an inverter, I will buy it. If I need a router, I will buy it. If I'm doing some renovation, I will complete it, etc., etc. It won't be that, or because it's Onam, I will go buy, some clothes and then I will buy some gifts and all that. I don't know whether that will happen this year, but we will have to wait and see. But definitely, we can see that there is increased demand for televisions. There is increased demand for dishwashing appliances, vacuum cleaners, etc. So we have stabilizers for dishwashers and microwave ovens. So we expect all these to do well. So that's my primarily expectation. Ram, you want to add anything to this?
Yeah, I think, pretty much what you said. My sense would be that, we should not analyze, this situation too much. Because, whatever numbers are coming, right, they are a consequence of, what I would say, demand supply challenges of various companies. Yeah, they are a consequence of what I would say essential purchases being made by people, right? So I think unless the COVID scenario changes, this picture is going to change. I think our industry is in that way. It looks like we are more fortunate than some other industries that demand has not hit us so hard because we are still able to, post lockdown, able to do, 80-85%, as you saw the last 2 months, yeah. And we think that, we should be able to do that in the coming 2-3 months for sure, yeah. So I think, we should not analyze this, too much. And, I think we should, we should wait and watch, yeah. I don't see, any companies, taking an aggressive posture and, making investments because we don't know. Because, see, the number of people who are taking calls, right, on, how future will be, that has increased, right? So, see, every district authority, is an independent authority and is authorized and empowered to take steps and measures as may be required to safeguard, the people, in that area. So, a lot of the local decisions are getting made. And so, we have, there is no certainty to say, how things will go. Therefore, I would say, I think that, we should wait and watch. And I think, this is a passing phase and, we should not spend too much time analyzing this because anybody, who is making a prediction is speculating, right? And that's what, we are observing. Because, if you take Kerala, we were in a good shape in Kerala. And now, look at what's happening, right? The cases are much, much more. And this is in spite and despite the efforts, right? So I think there's a lot of uncertainty still associated with this. And it would be good to, watch. Yeah?
So one more point on that. I think the key thing to watch is number of cases per district because definitely when the cases do drop in a particular district or an area, people do feel confident and they go and spend. So I think the best way to judge how things will go is keep analyzing that, and that is one lens. I don't think festive demand is going to be a key consideration this year because, see, the festive demand is a hype created by all companies by advertisements. I mean, the kind of money all the durable companies spend during Onam and Diwali is huge. I don't know whether this year they are in a financial position to do that. And even if they do that and after 1 week they realize the entire country goes to lockdown, what do you do with the money you spend? So these are the questions that are staring us in the face. And then, that's why we can't really make an answer now.
Got it. And just the second question, in terms of the inorganic, I know these times are trying times. We've been, looking at or considering inorganic opportunity. So given the current context, are you, keen on doing, or you think this is now kind of pushed by at least a couple of years in terms of any acquisition, etc.?
I wouldn't say a couple of years, but definitely a couple of quarters. I think we have been fortunate to have, targets that have been engaging with us. And we have been fortunate to, mutually agree to keep it on, the deep freezer or the back burner, as we call it. I don't think we require 2 years. I think by January, we'll be in a position to...
Got it. This is very helpful. Thank you so much.
Thank you. We would request the participants to please press star and one to ask a question. As there are no further questions, I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Hitesh Tong.
Thank you, Aisha. Thank you, sir, for your comments and insights, sir. Is there any closing remarks, sir?
No closing remarks. Thank you, ICICI, for hosting this call. And let's hope that we can overcome this pandemic. And everyone, please stay safe and listen to your local authorities. Thank you.